Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of The Boneshaker by Kate Milford, narrated by Erin Moon, and directed by Drew Sussman.
Chapter 1. The Town at the Crossroads. Missouri, 1913. Strange things can happen at a crossroads. It might look like nothing but a place where two dusty roads meet, but a crossroads can be something more. A crossroads can be something special, a compass with arms reaching to places you might never find the way to again. Places that might exist, or might have existed once, or might exist someday, depending on whether or not you decide to look for them. But whatever else it might be, a crossroads is a place where you choose. The town of Arcane sat very near one such place, a shallow bowl of waving grass and scrubby trees, where two highways met alongside the remnants of a dried-up river. On one of those highways, you could go all the way from Los Angeles, California, to Washington, D.C. A fellow could leave his home in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and visit family all the way north in Canada by way of the other. They were well-traveled roads, but there were great stretches of America along them where nothing much had yet been built. So Arcane and the other little towns that had sprung up here and there had hotels and saloons, dry goods general stores, and water pumps and stables for the travelers passing through. 100 years ago, there had been a town there where the roads met. But now it was only a deserted shell of bare foundations and uneasy walls that leaned at odd angles under collapsing roofs. The founders of Arcane had started from scratch a little ways down the east-west road, and the new town had grown up stronger and bigger than the husk they now called the Old Village. But maybe because of the nearness to that eerie, half-crumbled ghost town, travelers didn't stop off in Arcane for long. Folks bought their cans of gasoline or shoes for their horses, or had a wheel replaced. But if they thought they could make it to the next town, even if the wheel bumped or the horse limped a little, they would try. People didn't like to stop in Arcane if they could help it, even if they weren't sure why. Even the drifter, with the carpet bag and the old tin lantern slung on a pole over his shoulder, wasn't likely to linger for more than a meal and a night's rest before starting another long march. Although, with this particular drifter, it would be hard to say for certain. "My kind of town," he muttered, to no one in particular, as he paused where the two roads met to survey the tumble-down remains of a general store. Despite the glaring sun overhead, the lantern glowed dimly through a pattern of holes punched in the sides. It gave a quiet jangle as he turned to watch the progress of a little twist of swirling dust crossing his path. With his free hand, he yanked the felt hat off his head and wiped sweat from his forehead before shucking out of his long leather coat. He pulled a watch from his pocket, a rather nicer watch than one would expect a drifter to carry, and flipped it open. He glanced down the eastbound road, away from the town of Arcane, and made a noise of impatience before adjusting the carpet bag and the lantern and continuing on. He had a roustabout's lean muscle, and although life on the road usually put years on a man quicker than life in town, under the sweat and smudges of dirt, his face looked young. Only his eyes, light green like old glass and lined with wrinkles from squinting against the sun, gave any impression of age. The drifter smiled as he strode toward Arcane, but the smile was odd and awkward, and even he walked a little faster on his way out of the old village than he had on the way in. The people who lived in Arcane were just like anyone else. They went to work, kept kitchen gardens and cats and dogs, and had jobs and children and houses with broken screen doors or squeaky porch steps. The children waited all year for summer holidays, then for winter holidays, and presents, then for summer again. There were bullies and victims, rich kids and poor ones, like there are anywhere. But strange things can happen at a crossroads. And even if you were a perfectly normal child in a crossroads town, you'd grow up hearing stories, maybe even seeing one of those odd happenings yourself. For instance, by the time she was 13 years old, Natalie Minx knew all those strange stories by heart. She knew the one about how the old village became an abandoned shell, and all the tales of that ancient forest to the southwest of Arcane, in which strange things had walked long ago. She even knew why Mrs. Korisk, who kept a little farm at the north edge of town, insisted on living by candlelight when most everybody else had had electricity since before Natalie was born. It was hard sometimes to tell which stories were true and which ones weren't. But if Natalie was sure of anything, it was that in Arcane, you couldn't be sure of anything at all. Except maybe my family, Natalie thought, as her father slammed his finger in the big barn doors the way he always did when he came into his shop. Her family never seemed to change.
Found it,
he announced, waving a wrench over his head with his uninjured hand. Natalie reached for a bicycle tire hanging on the wall and used it to pull herself up onto one of his workbenches. How far's the trip?
About 110 miles.
Her father sucked in a breath.
Natalie, be—
A socket wrench on the bench launched itself from under her foot and skittered across the floor. No wonder her dad was always tripping over things in here. Natalie grabbed the tire again to keep from stepping on her father's collection of radio parts, only to have it spring away from the wall in her hand, her arms windmilled. Her father sprinted to catch her and took the most obstacle-laden route to do it, filling the shop with unmistakable sounds of destruction. Natalie caught her balance just in time to keep from landing on her backside on the shop floor, trampling any radio tubes, or worse, stepping on the little clockwork flyer she and her father were building together. Careful, she said as her father skidded uselessly to a halt beside where she stood on the workbench.
I know.
He gave her a severe look and picked his way back across the shop to return to what he'd been working on. She wouldn't have cared much about a bruise, but the flyer, which she and her dad called the Wilbur after the Wright brother who died only last year, was a mechanical labor of love. It was an automaton. The word itself was one of Natalie's newest and most favorite acquisitions. A small machine that would eventually move on its own when wound with a key. She set it aside gently, careful not to upset the gears inside it that controlled the tiny propellers and wings. On tiptoe, she could just see out the little window high on the wall above the workbench. She wiped a few years' worth of grime off the glass and stared at the crowd on the street. Of course, they were trying not to look like a crowd. But on any other Wednesday morning, half the town of Arcane would have had better things to do than try to look busy outside Minx's bicycle shop. You got an audience. Natalie stretched a little farther and saw a clutch of boys from school playing half-heartedly with a board balancing on a big tin can. A few girls nearby pretended to watch them. It was the first day of the summer holiday. For sure, the kids had better things to do. A big audience, Natalie said smugly. A A noise like a circus animal passing gas erupted from the hulk of machinery crouching at the center of the shop. It didn't sound healthy. Dad? Only her dad's lower half was visible. The top half was hidden in the boxy front of the machine. Natalie waited patiently until the thing was puttering rhythmically and asked again louder. Dad, it's going to run, right?
Sure.
His voice sounded like it was coming from inside a tin can. When he emerged to give her a sooty smile.
It'll work, I promise.
When Natalie ventured outside an hour later, the crowd on the street had doubled in size. No point in trying to melt into it. They were all watching her. She climbed up to sit on the edge of a rain barrel and nonchalantly shined an apple on her overalls. The first person to give up pretending he wasn't waiting for the big barn doors of Ted Minx's shop to open was a kid called George Sills. He sauntered over and gave Natalie a gap-toothed sneer. My dad says Doc Fitzwater's motor car couldn't make it across town, let alone all the way to Pinnacle. Natalie chewed her apple and made a point of watching old Tom Gio shuffle across the street with his crutch and tin guitar, instead of acknowledging George Sills. Tom was more interesting anyway. George was 14 and didn't like being ignored. He kicked the barrel she was sitting on hard enough to make Natalie grab the rim for balance. She gave him a withering glare. It's not just a motor car, it's a Winton. A lot of motor cars came through Arcane, and they weren't all the same. There were little runabouts and bigger touring cars, Stanhope-style and high-wheeler-style autos. Some of the older ones had tillers to steer with. The newer ones had steering wheels. Most had radiators to keep their engines cooled with water, although Natalie had seen a Franklin once that was air-cooled and looked a little odd without a big radiator sticking up in front. Doc's car, like most of them, had to be wound with a crank to start up. But the new Cadillacs started electrically, and they came with electric lamps. Natalie had seen nearly all the Fords, except the Model A, and could even tell the difference between the N, S, and T models. She had seen a few kinds of Bakers, a Moon, and a Speedwell, even a Fiat from Italy, and an Oldsmobile Limited limousine earlier this year. That was a pretty motor car. The Winton, though? The Winton was beautiful. But explaining the difference to George Sills would be like trying to teach the alphabet to a puppy. Who cares what kind it is? It's 10 years old. Dad says Doc could drive it over to the soda fountain, maybe, but only because it's downhill all the way. Sure, if it was up to your dad. If it was up to your dad, Doc's motor car wouldn't make it 10 feet. Natalie spat a seed to the ground. Your dad couldn't change a bicycle tire. George's hands curled instantly into fists. Natalie jumped down, shoved her bangs out of her face, and brought up her knuckles the way Jack Johnson did in boxing pictures. If George was stupid enough to try anything in front of the whole town, she'd abandon all scruples and go straight for the knee he was still favoring after their last fight. Her third, no, fourth, thrashing from George this month. But before either of them could make a move at the other, the lumpy head of an alligator landed on George Sills's shoulder. He took one look, made a sound like a creaky window being shoved up, and jumped back about 4 feet. The leathery, shrunken head was little, brown, and attached to the end of a cane in the hand of a man as tall and thin and pale as a birch tree.
His white hair stood up in wind-blown shocks all over his head, and his face had more lines than space between.
"I'll have you know a fellow drove a motor car like mine all the way from California to New York before there were proper roads across the country, Master Sills."
"Hi, Dr. Fitzwater."
George tried to look as though he hadn't just screamed like a little girl. Doc wore a monocle in one eye. The look he gave George through the little gold-rimmed lens made the boy turn tail and flee across the street. Then he took the monocle out and began to shine it with his handkerchief. The look he gave Natalie without it was much kinder.
"I understand you were in charge of polishing, Miss Minx. I expect the old beast will blind us all when it comes into the sun."
His voice didn't match his creased and pitted face. It was more like the way new tires ran over smooth dirt roads, a steady, low sound like a purr. She opened her mouth to tell Doc how pretty the motor car looked now, but the metallic whine of rusty hinges interrupted her. Every head in the street turned. The shop doors were opening. Ted Minx, sooty-faced and grinning, appeared in the dark gap between the big barn doors. He pushed one wide, then the other, and disappeared back into the shadows. A moment later, the broad nose of the Winton emerged. It was a dark red motor car, with two high, tufted leather seats open to the air, and wheels with spokes, just like bicycle tires. Two of its headlamps were like eyes set back on either side, wide like a frog's, and the third was a single cyclopean eyeball in a brass casing, fixed right in the middle of the radiator. It had a steering wheel stuck up in front of the seat on the right-hand side. The brass fittings and trim that Natalie had polished so obsessively glowed. She caught George Sills's eye across the street and stuck out her tongue. "Hey, Doc," her father called, wiping the sweat off his forehead and leaving broad, grimy fingerprints there instead. "How about a drive?" Doc made a show of considering.
"Wouldn't want to disappoint all of the good folks who happen by to see me off."
"Guess we better see if your car works after all."
Mr. Minx spotted Natalie leaning on her barrel.
"Mind giving me a little help, Natty?"
Mind? She was in the driver's seat almost before he finished talking, fingers wrapped securely around the wheel, just in case. Her father turned the crank with both hands.
"Ready?"
"Ready."
It sputtered to life, just as he promised it would, and the street around them erupted into applause.
"Listen to the old beast growl."
Doc Fitzwater put a gnarled palm on the steering wheel.
"I can't believe you did all this in just 3 days.
Natalie resisted the urge to smirk at George again. Anyway, her dad could have fixed the Winton up even faster if he'd wanted to. She had spent more time pestering him to let her help than he'd spent on the motor car itself, until the three of them, Natalie, her brother Charlie, and her father, had had to work through the night to get it ready for today. Now Doc turned to Mr. Minx and spoke quietly, his back to the crowd.
"I'm going as far as the Perry's farm today. Then by tomorrow afternoon, I'll be in Pinnacle, and you can ring the Central Exchange if you need me. Maybe sooner, if Maggie Perry doesn't insist on having a giant brunch before I leave."
Natalie's father nodded, smiled tightly, and held out his hand to shake Doc's.
"Nothing to worry about,"
Doc said. Natalie climbed reluctantly out of the driver's seat, while Charlie put Doc's old Gladstone medical bag and his pebbly leather suitcase in the back of the motor car. Doc turned to face the people on the street and shouted over the puttering engine.
If I didn't know better, I'd think you all came out for the old Winton, not for me.
He climbed into the seat and propped up his alligator head cane beside him.
As soon as the epidemic in Pinnacle's under control, I'll chug straight back. In the meantime, Lester's ready to step in if anyone gets a headache while I'm gone.
Naturally, red-faced Lester Finch looked pretty nervous to Natalie as he waved from the doorway of the pharmacy a little ways down the street. Then again, when had she seen him looking any other way? Natalie looked around at the assembled town. There was her little gang of friends, a pair of boys and one prissy-looking girl. There was George Sills, giving them all the evil eye. Her teacher, Miss Tillerman. Mr. Maliverney, who ran the saloon. And a drifter with a carpet bag and an old lantern at his feet. The drifter had the delighted look of a kid who'd stumbled on a sporting event. He caught Natalie's glance and winked one pale green eye. There was Mr. Swift, the smith from Ogle's stables, the woman Natalie privately thought of as the town hag, Mrs. Byron, who was, as usual, scowling disapprovingly at her, Simon Coffret, the man who lived in Arcane's only mansion, flipping his pocket watch over and over in his fingers as he watched the scene over the rims of his glasses, and tiny, bent, old Chester Teufels, in his shabby, threadbare suit, being studiously ignored by everyone around him, as he stood in an unobtrusive corner chewing on a fingernail. Nothing out of the ordinary here. Her gaze passed over all the excited or doubtful or curious folks watching Doc in his motor car, until her eyes fell on old Tom Guillou's face, black and craggy and sharp-planed as a nugget of coal, and his ancient tin guitar slung over one shoulder. Old Tom was watching her. Natalie tilted her head. Was that so odd? After all, a minute ago she'd been the center of attention, sitting up in the driver's seat. But Tom wasn't just looking at her. He was watching her. All the while his head nodded slightly, as if to say, yes, you're right, yes. She looked away quickly, blushing a little, as if she'd been the one caught staring. Her gaze landed on Simon Coffret, and she flinched. There was no mistaking it. Mr. Coffret was watching her too. It came out of nowhere. One minute, she was just another part of the excitement of Doc's departure. The next, she was part of something else entirely. Something was happening here that had nothing to do with Doc's motor car. Something was happening here that she didn't understand. Or something was going to happen. A grinding pop drew her attention. Doc releasing the brake. Once again, Natalie was just a 13-year-old girl standing with her curious neighbors, watching an old man drive an old motor car out of town on an ordinary June morning. They followed him down Bard Street, the main road through Arcane, then watched him go as far as the crossroads, where he became a dark little speck heading east. Soon, he was out of sight. What's an epidemic? The moment it was out, Natalie wished she hadn't asked. Annie Minx always took questions seriously, which meant you had to be careful what you asked and when. The kitchen was smoky already, and her mother didn't need anybody's help to burn another batch of pancakes. She turned away from the stovetop with the eager look she got when she was about to explain something. Natalie sighed. It's when a lot of people get sick with the same thing at the same time, like the Black Plague, or smallpox, or influenza. Behind her, a plume of gray collected over the griddle. Like what's happening in Pinnacle? Natalie asked, staring at the stovetop. The pancakes had smelled good for a minute, too. Mama? Her mother opened her mouth to answer, then sniffed the air and remembered she was cooking. Natalie propped her chin up with her fists, elbow resting on the table, and watched Mrs. Minx turn the pancakes one by one to reveal their burned black bellies. People said Natalie and her mother looked alike. It was hard to tell at 13, though. Her mother was tall and liked brightly colored lawn dresses and shoes with heels, and her hair seemed perfectly happy all twisted up at the back of her head the way she had it right now. She had a compact of face powder that smelled like sunlight, and a string of pearls that had belonged to Natalie's grandmother, which Natalie had worn exactly once in a school play. She was, Natalie thought it was fair to say, beautiful. Natalie wore dresses under protest. Overalls were much more convenient, and her favorite shoes were a pair long outgrown by her brother. Her hair mostly stayed in a ponytail nowadays, but a few pieces still insisted on coming loose, although those bits were growing out pretty well, considering how short she'd had to cut them a few months back. There had been an incident at school with some glue that she was pretty sure was George Sills's doing. On the other hand, Natalie's disorderly hair was just about the same shade of nearly black as her mother's, and her eyes were almost the same color too. Light brown, the color of coffee made just the way her mother liked, with a slosh of cream and a homemade sugar cube and a tablespoon of rum. Usually, starting about May, they even got the same wildly multiplying batch of freckles across their noses, which they would compare at the end of each sunny day, looking for any new matching spots. This year, though, Natalie's freckles were even more profuse than usual. Lately, her mother's face looked downright pale by comparison. Mrs. Minx scraped the blackened pancakes into a pail with the rest of the spoiled ones and poured fresh batter on the griddle. In Pinnacle, they just have a persistent sort of flu, but it's got a lot of people sick. Natalie decided to keep quiet until at least one batch made it safely onto a plate. Her stomach was grumbling, and the kitchen was getting hot. Then she remembered something. Mr. Finch looked worried when Doc left. Her mother's shoulders did something funny, as if she'd felt a sudden draft. Well, people will be expecting Mr. Finch to fill Doc's shoes while he's gone. I'm sure that's upsetting to him. But Mr. Finch knows how to give out medicines and take care of people, doesn't he? Yes, but it's not the same as having Doc. Her voice did something chilly, similar to what her shoulders had done a moment before. It's not the same. Not the same. Not much of an answer by anybody's standards, let alone her mother's. Still, it looked like this might be the one, the batch that survived. Natalie bit her lips to keep quiet while the edges of the pancake set. 2 more minutes, maybe less. Then her father and Charlie came in, smelling like the rough soap they used to get the oil and grime of the bicycle shop off.
You didn't need to cook,
Natalie's father said. Mrs. Minx turned and hugged her husband tightly. It looked like the end of the pancake's last chance for survival until Charlie took the spatula out of her thin hand and removed them from the skillet himself. What happens? Natalie asked when all four of them were seated with breakfast safely on the table. If people start getting sick here?
Mr. Finch will take care of it, Charlie said.
Mama says it's not the same. Their mother looked at her plate. Mr. Finch is fine. But that's not what you said. For a moment, there was quiet around the table.
I'm sure Lester Finch won't think twice about wiring a message to Doc and Pinnacle,
Natalie's father said, looking at his wife. Just send a wire? Natalie demanded. That's all? But what if it's the Pinnacle flu? How would we know?
Mr. Finch could tell if the flu from Pinnacle showed up here, Charlie put in.
Natalie shot him a shut up, will you, look. Since when did her brother know anything about flus? Flus, epidemics, persistent strange ailments, and know-it-all big brothers. She emerged from her thoughts just in time to hear her father say,
I bet I know how Natalie's going to spend the first day of the summer.
Can we work on my automaton? I found a piece that only fits when it's backwards, so the cam doesn't...
I think I need a day away from gears, Natty. Besides, he said with a smile, don't you have something to show off to Miranda and the rest of your gang?
He looked so proud. Oh, yeah, I guess I forgot. She dropped her chin back onto her fist and drew circles in the maple syrup on her plate with her fork. While Natalie fidgeted at her kitchen table and Doc Fitzwater made his steady chugging way out of town, another crowd in another dusty village watched a little caravan prepare for a different departure. At the reins of the wagon in front, a tall man in blue-lensed spectacles stood and waved, smiling a showman's smile that didn't reach his eyes. The hands that held the reins wore expensive leather gloves in a pearly, pale ivory shade. A silk top hat sat on the seat beside him, and his mane of red hair, shot through with gray, shone in the sun. It waved about, a touch more than it seemed it ought to in the soft breeze. He sat with a whirl of dark cloak and flicked his wrists. The wagon lurched into motion, the first in a train of more old and peeling wagons drawn by mottled mules. The procession left a rattle of glass and the faint carnival smell of fresh hay, frying grease, and spun candy in its wake. The caravan turned westward, toward Arcane. Chapter 2. The World's Fastest Bicycle. Natalie's life was a mess of gears and yarns. If you looked closely, however, the way she loved to look at a mechanical device or a story, the tangle resolved itself into a perfectly crafted mechanism. All the parts were made to work together, in the same way that Natalie could tell when she was looking at a well-built machine. She knew her life was pretty good. Everything just fit. Arcane, however, was different. The more complex a machine got, and the more parts it contained, the more places there were where gears could fail to mesh. A town was like that. Sometimes it just didn't seem to work quite as smoothly as it did at other times, especially when the oil that eased the cogs meshing ran out. Like now, for instance. It was barely past supper time. Doc hadn't even been gone a whole day. And already, the town's cogs were starting to stick. It was in the air, something strange and hard to pin down.
Natalie paused outside Lester Finch's pharmacy. Inside, despite the late hour, Mr. Finch still had customers lined up at the counter. She leaned her bright red enameled bicycle against her side and considered the shopfront.
Don't you think there's got to be something odd going on out there in Pinnacle if Doc has to go and clean house for them? Natalie wondered. What's the matter with their doctor?
I don't know. Miranda Porter twisted a finger disinterestedly in one blonde curl and half shrugged. Then she put her hands on her hips and gave Natalie a critical look.
You're wearing that silly thing again?
Natalie frowned and made an effort not to feel for the tiny brass sprocket she wore like a charm on a string around her neck. Just because Miranda couldn't think of anything better to talk about than necklaces didn't mean Natalie was going to sink to that level. Pay attention. Natalie jerked her head toward the pharmacy. It's probably some awful kind of deadly sickness, like the Black Plague. Anybody else would have picked up the cue, hissed in horror, and joined the game with another ghastly suggestion as to what was going on in the next town over, as gruesome and vile as possible. It would have made Natalie feel better, for sure. Just a little bit of normal behavior, for goodness sake. Was that too much to ask? Miranda had been really good at those kinds of games once. But lately, she seemed to find them beneath her. Natalie had given up trying to figure it out. Now, predictably, Miranda just shrugged again. Who cares? Pinnacle's practically in another state. Hopeless and lacking factual information. An unforgivable combination. It isn't. It's 110 miles, Natalie snapped. Who cares? Miranda folded her arms bossily over her chest. Her eyes flicked around, looking to see if anybody was watching, probably. When are you going to let me ride your bicycle? Natalie stopped dead in her tracks. Strange ailments forgotten. Why would you want to ride my bicycle? She demanded. Who are you trying to impress? Miranda's mouth squeezed itself into a tight little line. Nobody. I bet it's Alfred Tate. Amazing. Miranda turned the same pink as her dress. Shut your... Thought so, Natalie laughed. Miranda, you can't ride it. You'll get your dress caught in the springs. Miranda plunked her hands on her hips. I will not. Natalie propped the item in question carefully against a hitching post and regarded Miranda's pink calico dress so skeptically that her friend looked down to see if she had put on something absurd like an old-fashioned hoop skirt without noticing it. I'm looking out for you, Miranda. That's all. Don't want Alfred Tate to see your dress tear straight off because it's caught up, do you? Miranda glanced around before she could help herself. He's not here. So it's okay for everybody else to see your bloomers? All right, then. You ride it. Natalie's heart sank. If it's really the fastest bicycle in the world, show me. Pink hands on her pink hips, pink face draining to an angry white. Miranda tapped her foot, raising little puffs of dry dirt around her ankles. Natalie decided to tough it out. No. Because it probably isn't, and you don't want anyone to find out. Because it's late. Because you're pestering me, and I don't feel like it. Anything to stop this conversation. Natalie grabbed the bicycle's handlebars and stalked away. Miranda got the point, for once, and didn't try to keep up. How do you know it's the fastest bicycle in the world? You don't know that. I helped my dad build it.
I know what it's made of.
Yeah?
Miranda yelled after her. It's made of bicycle parts. Like any other bicycle, that's all. Natalie stopped again and whirled on Miranda.
Like any other?
People were so stupid. You only had to look at the bicycle to see that it was special. The frame alone was a work of art, and the rest of it was made of parts from the best bicycles there were, each piece picked out specially by her father to build Natalie the fastest, most perfect, most beautiful bicycle in all of Missouri, if not the entire world. It was unquestionably one of a kind. It was just Natalie's size, and the whole frame, enameled in her favorite shade of red, was etched with a pattern of whorls and curlicues. It had a varnished wicker basket attached to the back instead of the front, where it might have slowed the bicycle down, and the basket had a leather strap with a new brass buckle, so that no matter how fast she rode and no matter how bumpy the street, Natalie's belongings would stay safely inside. Best of all, her father had sent away to Dayton, Ohio, for an actual Wright Cycle Company nameplate from back when the Wright brothers were still building bicycles. A little oval badge with a pointy top and bottom that now gleamed at the front of the handlebar stem. If Miranda Porter, in her ignorance, couldn't see that it was the best bicycle in the country, well then, after 13 years of life, she at least ought to understand it was better than anything she, Miranda, had ever seen. Or probably ever would. As for fast? Natalie had asked her father for the fastest bicycle he could build, and he had built her this one. Nobody but nobody was better at bicycles than Ted Minx. So the fastest bicycle from Natalie's father clearly had to be the fastest there was. In the world. Ever. It was just good logic. Maybe Miranda was just that big an idiot, and she simply tried harder to hide it when the boys were around. You couldn't talk to an idiot about all the extra springs in the frame that would let Natalie fly over rough roads, the beveled gears, or the very special tires that wouldn't skid, the motorcycle pedals, or the chrome-plated electric light between the handlebars that had been ordered from Chicago. It would be like trying to explain the Winton motor car to George Sills. It's old, Miranda protested. How could anything so old be fast? That just doesn't make any sense. Natalie glared. If you're talking about the frame, Miranda, it's not old. Well, antique, I guess I should have said. But that just means old, Natalie. Miranda said with a meanly sympathetic smile. Why couldn't your dad find you something newer? I mean, if he was going to build you a bicycle in the first place? This was hopeless, an absolutely hopeless endeavor. Natalie settled for yelling. You don't know anything! And breaking into a run alongside the bike. You can't prove it! Miranda's voice dripped victory. Natalie's face burned. I bet it's slow. Miranda bawled. The slowest, oldest, most rickety thing there is. You won't ride it because then everyone would see and know. The world took on the same red as the bicycle, and the guilt that had been eating away at Natalie's stomach since breakfast started to boil. Tears hit her cheeks and dripped down into the dust under the tires. She kept running until she could turn a corner and get off Bard Street. When she was safely out of sight, she propped the bicycle carefully, lovingly, against a wall. Then she sat hard, dropped her head onto her knees, and sobbed.
I'm sorry, Dad,
she said into her tear-wet overalls. She couldn't prove Miranda wrong, not even to defend her father, the most brilliant mechanic in Arcane and Missouri and America and the world. If she had been able to hop on and pedal with every ounce of energy she had, Miranda would have had to take back all those awful things she'd just said. But that was impossible. Natalie Minx, the girl with the world's fastest bicycle, couldn't ride it. After a few minutes, she wiped her face dry on her shirt and got up. If Miranda saw this display, she'd think she was right. Parallel to Bard Street, between the livery stable where Doc had kept his motor car for years, and the smithy behind it, where Mr. Swift, the blacksmith, lived and worked, a little alley called Smith Lane stretched, just wide enough for three people to walk side by side. Now Natalie walked the bicycle with as much poise as she could muster around the livery stable to the alley, swung her leg over the crossbar, and put a foot on one pedal. The particularly marvelous thing about a bicycle, or an automaton, or a Winton motor car, or any mechanical thing at all, really, was the way that it was made up of lots of pieces doing specific jobs. The insides of Natalie's flyer, for instance, were a beautiful puzzle, a jumble of parts. Once she put the puzzle together, those parts would work together at last, and the flyer would do what she had built it to do. Once you could see how all the parts fit together and understand what their special jobs were, you could understand the machine. For Natalie, that was enough to make mechanical things beautiful, especially in the moment when suddenly, after staring at a puzzle of cams and cogs and wheels, it all came together and made sense. Except for this exceedingly simple machine in her hands. Just like riding any other bicycle, she said softly and kicked off. One foot off the ground, and then the other. But the bicycle was already tilting. She flung her body the other way, too hard, and put out her hand to keep from falling into the stable wall. Her palm whacked the rough boards and slid down along with the rest of her as the wheels shot out sideways. She bit down to keep from crying out as her leg twisted painfully under the frame. Her palm burned. There would be splinters to soak out later. She shook her hand a few times and hopped to her feet, then got back on the bicycle. This time, she kicked off too hard, so the pedals spun and she couldn't get her feet on them. After a minute, she lost her balance and fell again. The third time, she glanced down to put her feet squarely on the spinning pedals, leaned too far to the right, and steered straight into the stable wall. Unbelievable. The thing had a mind of its own. The problem, of course, was that riding the red bicycle wasn't like riding any other bicycle, not by a long shot. Mr. Minx had bought it in Kansas City the year before from a shop that was going out of business, along with a whole tangle of frames and tires and pedals and gears. The second Natalie saw it, she had begged him to fix it up for her. Even filthy from sitting for decades in someone's shop, its heavy old metal wheels rusting and bent out of true, and all its crimson enamel and etchings coated in grime. It was beautiful and different. It had a downturned set of handlebars with rosewood grips. Its wheels were bigger than Natalie was used to, and they were less than 6 inches apart, which was a lot closer together than was normal on newer cycles. The one in the front was bigger by a little bit than the one in the back, too. Instead of a seat on a vertical saddle post, this bicycle's seat was positioned on a nearly horizontal bar that sloped from the steering column to a spring over the rear tire, just one of a collection of springs supporting it in various odd places. It had a longer front fender than any other bicycle she'd seen, and the fender had two little hooks on either side of it that were meant to hold the rider's feet when he or she wanted to coast without pedaling. That should have been the big tip-off, that this was going to be a difficult bicycle. But even that wasn't its weirdest and most interesting feature. Below the triangle that held the seat and connected the steering column to the fork of the rear wheel, another set of tubes completed the frame. A diamond, cut in half by a vertical piece that formed a hinge between the front part and the back. The red enameled frame was built so that it could actually pivot at the middle.
"I don't know, Natty," her father had said, looking critically at it. "I don't think it's the best choice for you. I have a feeling whatever I do to it, any bicycle built on this frame is going to ride like a bone shaker."
Natalie groaned. She'd ridden a bone shaker before, or at least she'd tried to ride it. Mr. Minx still had his father's Michaud velocipede somewhere in the shop, and if you could get going on it, which was a very big if, it rattled and shook you even on the smoothest roads till your teeth fairly chattered in your skull. Instead of tires with air in them, bone shakers had wooden or metal wheels, so every bump on the road went straight from the wheels to the frame to the rider.
"But what if we put better tires on it?" she protested, looking wistfully at the upward curl of the front fender. It would be such a pretty machine if it was fixed up. "And what about all the springs? Won't the springs help it ride better?"
"I think they're there to compensate for a bad design," Mr. Mink said, scowling at the springs in question. "In fact, I don't remember ever seeing a frame so over-designed before."
"What about the hinge in the middle? Didn't you say that was to help it steer and turn better?"
"Well, that's the idea, but I'll tell you what. We'll fix it up with the best parts we can find. I'll do my best to make it smooth and fast. Then you can decide how you like it."
He'd finished the red bicycle when he was supposed to be working on Doc Fitzwater's car, and it was everything Natalie had believed it would be. But sure enough, despite its supporting springs and brand new tires, it bounced along like a century-old bone shaker. And the pedals were in a weird place. And it was geared funny, so that each cycle of the pedals turned the front wheel, the one that drove the bicycle, in two complete revolutions. This was one of the tricks her father had used to make it faster, but it was messing up Natalie's best running starts. And worst of all, it turned out, was the pivoting hinge in the middle. It meant the bicycle responded to the slightest angle, the slightest lean. It meant Natalie had to totally relearn how to balance and steer. And it meant she ran into things a lot. She loved it, nonetheless. All she had to do was figure out how to ride it before her father found out how much trouble it was giving her. But something about this bicycle, this weirdly perfect, beautiful bicycle, was impossible to control. It seemed to want to fight her, and for some reason, it always won. After attempt number 10, in which, during a particularly fast-running start, her pant leg got caught in one of those hooks on the front wheel as she was trying to hold her feet out of the way of the whirling pedals, Natalie decided she'd had enough. No way was Ted Minx's daughter going to fail to ride any bicycle, not with nearly a decade of prime bicycle riding experience under her belt. Today, however, the bicycle won. Again. She heard the music as she limped out of the alley. Back on Bard Street, old Tom Gio
sat on the ground with his back against the front of the livery stable, legs stretched out in front of him, and his tin guitar on his lap. The round brass resonator, set into the middle of the instrument, caught the reddening light and shone like a setting sun all by itself. Old Tom spoke without looking at her.
"You all right there, darling?"
His words came out just a little muffled by the flattened crown cap he held between his teeth. Natalie felt a flush, hot as a midsummer sunburn, sweep over her face. But she was too tired and sore to run away from him the way she'd fled Miranda.
"Did you see?" Was her voice always that small?
"Can't see much of anything with that old sun coming down right in my eyes. I heard something like a..."
Natalie held her breath.
"Don't say fall."
Instead, the long-nailed fingers of his right hand halted their nimble plucking and scrabbled in the guitar strings, fumbling a little as her feet had fumbled for the pedals. And then he struck the flat front of the guitar with his palm. The noise was exactly like Natalie falling elaborately off her bicycle, kicking a few spokes on the way down, and finishing with a swinging handlebar whacking the ground before bouncing back to hit her in the head. The sounds he made were so strange and improbable and fascinating that she hardly minded that they were mimicking one of her humiliating spills.
"How do you do that?"
Tom slid his left hand up the neck of the guitar. On that hand, the fingernails were short and neatly trimmed. And on one finger, he wore a piece of brown glass, like a finger-length ring, that he slid along the strings. The instrument wailed like an opera singer on a Victrola record.
"Lots of voices in a guitar."
He let the operatic note hold for a moment, then started back into the song he'd been playing when she'd first come out of the alley, pausing only to take the flattened cap from between his teeth to use for a guitar pick. After a little while, he closed his eyes and started humming along. The memory of her battles with her bicycle faded. The sounds of horses in the stable and buggies in the street dissolved. Tom's humming turned into strange syllables, sounds that weren't words, but sort of broken pieces of words. Bits and bobs of song, dodging and darting over and around and under the music of the guitar, rising and falling and ducking, and every once in a while, climbing sharp and clear and plaintive. Tom's teeth flashed bright against his dark skin. Lines came and went between his eyes and on his forehead, and the corners of his mouth twisted into smiles and scowls to make room for those pieces of words to escape. Sometimes, he would stop singing and slap the side of his hand against the strings or his palm against the tin front of the guitar as if it were a drum, nodding his head along and then picking up right where he'd left off. It made a strange tableau, and plenty of people paused to look. The old black man singing blissfully with the guitar flashing sunset colors on his knees, and the sweaty, bruised, and scraped girl, unmoving and rapt, absently holding on to a bizarre bicycle with her head cocked like a bird's. Neither of them noticed anyone else's stares.
"I know something about old Tom."
The thought had barely taken shape in Natalie's consciousness when his voice launched into a string of syllables bursting with Z's and B's, and she forgot to think about what that something was. Inevitably, the song came to an end. Tom's eyes opened at last, and he smiled at Natalie.
"What was it? That extraordinary thing about old Tom Gio?"
As she stood there thinking, trying to remember something just out of reach, it hit her again, harder this time. The sense of something happening, or something poised to happen, perhaps. Something she could sense, but not put a finger on. Something strange in her already odd little town that she could feel to the marrow of her bones, and that made goosebumps come springing up on her arms. A sudden motion of Tom's hands made a piece of metal near the top of the neck of the guitar catch a flare of sunlight. And then, with a dizzy, lurching sensation that started at the back of her throat and flowed upward, so that for just the briefest second her whole head spun, two things popped into Natalie's head. The first was a crystal clear image of old Tom Gio sitting beside a fire at the crossroads outside of town, hammering something round and gold-colored into the folded piece of metal that now held up the strings of his guitar. The second thing was what she had been trying to remember while Tom and his guitar sang with their peculiar voices. Two words. The devil. Natalie muttered something about home and dinner and grabbed the bicycle's handlebars and ran so hard and so blindly that she almost sprinted straight into the side of a passing carriage. The carriage horse shied sideways, stamping in annoyance, and Natalie turned to call out an apology to the driver. As she glanced back, she noticed something strange. Tom had tucked his crown cap pick between his teeth and begun playing again. Only this song was sadder, softer, remorseful, or reproachful, perhaps. He wasn't looking at Natalie anymore. She followed his eyes to the saloon across the street at the corner of Bard and Sanctuary. On the porch, Mr. Malaverney, the saloon keeper, was pouring tea from a cracked pot into a china cup on the table in front of Simon Coffret. Behind the lenses of his spectacles, Mr. Coffret's eyes were on Tom. Then, when Mr. Malaverney didn't move away after he had finished pouring, Simon looked at the saloon keeper. There it was again. Natalie, frozen over her bicycle, felt something tighten in her throat, a moment of dizziness at the root of her tongue. Once, her mother had told her of how, as a little girl, she'd suffered from vertigo, which had sounded a lot like the way this felt. The world twitched, and instead of one Simon Coffret, she saw him separate into multiple specters that danced neatly around the first, like photographic negatives without shadows. Natalie shut her eyes and pressed on her eyelids. Only once before, when she'd been hit by a baseball, had Natalie's vision ever done anything like that? Thud. When she opened her eyes, she was flat in the street, the bicycle lying in the dirt beside her. Natalie pushed herself up, rubbing her head. Puffs of dust settled around her. It felt as if she'd fallen straight back onto her tailbone, hard. From opposite sides of the street, Tom Gio and Simon Coffret were coming toward her, concern on both their faces. The specters that had moved around Simon were gone. Face burning, Natalie scrambled to her feet on her own, righted the bicycle, and ran away without looking back. The last of the sun cast long purple shadows, painting a stretched-out, abnormally tall skeleton of wheels and frame on the road as Natalie arrived home. The bicycle, of course, was perfectly fine. She herself was a mess, and she couldn't get those two words out of her head. The devil. She found her mother already in bed upstairs, reading Harper's Magazine and listening to Enrico Caruso on the Victrola. "What on earth were you up to?" Mrs. Minx demanded, Natalie submitted to a thorough examination of barked elbows and shins.
Not another fight?
No, just had a bumpy ride.
Is it that late?
Not since there's no school tomorrow. Natalie, these scrapes are filthy. She pushed back the covers with a sigh.
Go get some water.
Natalie scrambled down the stairs ahead of her mother, grabbed a pitcher from the kitchen, and walked outside to the pump by the vegetable garden. Inside, her mother chipped ice from the block in the icebox into a bowl.
You're sure this wasn't a fight, Natty?
She demanded when Natalie returned with the pitcher. Mrs. Minx carried the bowl to the table, dropped into the nearest chair, and wiped her forehead with the back of her hand.
I mean to say absolutely sure.
Positive. Which wasn't entirely true. But Natalie was fairly certain her mother wasn't talking about fights with inanimate objects. She dunked a towel in the water and scrubbed at the scrapes until she thought they might pass for clean.
How's that?
Passable. Mrs. Minx twisted the ice up in another towel and handed it across the table. That goes on your leg before that goose egg gets any bigger. She rose and rummaged in a cabinet for a tube of ointment.
Are you going back to bed, Mama? You look tired.
I am, Sunshine. You can stay up, though. Not too late, but a little longer is fine.
If I wanted a bedtime story, though, are you going to sleep right now?
Mrs. Minx paused in her search and regarded Natalie cautiously.
You can't be tired.
Natalie faked a yawn. Her mother, ointment in hand, gave an exaggerated sigh and started up the stairs. Natalie followed, grinning, up to her own little bedroom, shucked off her clothes, yanked her nightgown on backwards, and sat primly on the edge of her bed.
So, you're telling me you're ready for bed before it's even dark out?
Mrs. Minx's eyes were suspicious.
Which story did you want?
There. She was hooked. There was nothing, nothing Natalie's mother liked better.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.